Go ahead.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the first ever virtual McCormick Sport Leaders Forum, brought to you by our title sponsor, Scout Sports and Entertainment. Over the next 3 days, you'll be immersed in 3 keynotes and 8 panels for our registrants. We have some incredible speakers in store for you, and we cannot wait for you to hear them. We would like to thank our title sponsor, Scout Sports and Entertainment, for supporting us in the virtual world. Thank you to all of our sponsors who are powering each of our sessions, our lovely advisors, the McCormick Department of Sport Management, and especially all of you for showing up and being ready to engage with our speakers this week.
Before we jump into our keynote of the day, we'd like to take a few moments to recognize the 2020 committee from last year. As some of you may know, the COVID-19 pandemic threw a wrench in the event that they worked so tirelessly on. Though the event did not happen, we want to recognize the efforts and preparation they gave our team moving forward. They truly supported us and gave us the tools to make this event thrive. So thank you to our 2020 committee for all of your hard work.
Now, on to our keynote for today, powered by 47 Brand. Today, we will be hearing from Johan Alvkos, who's a 4-time Olympic gold medalist in speed skating and the founder of Right to Play. Johan has dedicated himself to growing Right to Play into an international non-government organization that operates in 20 countries and reaches over 2 million children each week. Johan is currently the second vice president of the Norwegian Confederation of Sport and Olympic Committee. He is an internationally recognized social entrepreneur who has been widely acknowledged for his work in promoting the use of sport and play as a tool for positive childhood development. We have a brief video introducing Johan before we start his keynote address. We please ask that everyone stays mute during this time.
I went to Africa.
I met this group of boys with 12-year-olds, and one of them were very popular. I asked, "Why are you so popular?" And he said, "Can't you see? I have long sleeves."
Took his shirt off, rolled it together, and sleeves made a knot, and that became a ball, and that's how they could play soccer in the streets.
They were traumatized. They lost friends and family members in the war.
And they wanted one thing: the opportunity to play.
Cheering Johan Alvkos as he tries to break the world mark. Here he comes. He's got it. World record for Koss.
His journey had started and ended with the same simple conviction. As a boy, Johan Alvkos had decided he was going to be the best speed skater in the world. On the world's biggest stage, he had proved it. But as he celebrated that day, a piece of Koss's mind had already raced out of the arena. He was already pondering a much grander plan for what he was going to do next.
The Olympic Aid program was going to build schools and teacher institution and do that type of thing. They weren't going to bring sport equipment. So I asked the Norwegian kids through the media, and to say, "Hey, do you have any sport equipment lying around which I can bring back to Eritrea?" And I had no idea. I mean, there was an amazing response just before we're leaving. The newspaper in Norway writes, "Koss is bringing soccer balls to starving kids. What an idiot." That's when I got nervous. Nobody had really told me that I was an idiot before, and certainly not on the front page. I did not know much about international development either, and I thought, you know, maybe this is not the right thing. But I couldn't stop. We went up to the president. I met the president of Eritrea, and I asked him, so I said, "You know, you have asked for food and I'm bringing sport equipment. I made a mistake. I'm sorry." And then he looks at me and said, "You know, this is the greatest gift we ever received. It's the first time we feel like human beings. It's something more than just to be kept alive." I felt more like that was a starting point to something different.
Koss had realized that establishing an organization independent from the Olympics was the best way to promote his vision.
Olympic AIDS stood for every child's right to play.
And we thought, you know, there is no better name for us in the sports movement to create right to play, because every child should have the right to play.
In this game, you communicate together in order to score a goal. Isn't it correct?
Yes!
The objective of this game is immense. Let these children play today to learn how to lead tomorrow.
In addition to having fun and playing, they really learn through the games. Basic life skills, or it is in the area of health.
When I begin the game, I'll call malaria. Malaria will come. White blood cell, we have to come in and push, gently push malaria away.
It's not the winning or losing. It is the process. It is the team building.
Where girls are traditionally excluded from play, cultural standards would need to be delicately shifted to make change gradually visible.
We went talk with parents to allow them to join our activity because it's right to play for everyone.
Child by child, nation by nation, Right to Play continued to explore ways to use sport to make lives better. And along the way, the program also succeeded in its secondary mission, getting as many athletes as possible involved alongside the children.
Do you think every child should have the right to play?
Yes.
I don't hear you.
Yes.
No, I can't still hear you.
Yes.
In many ways, this feels like I have an opportunity to give back for all of the things I've been given in my life. And as I look at it, this work gives me much, much more than I still feel I can give to the world.
Sometimes, the simplest ideas are the most revolutionary.
Johan, how are you? It's good to see you again.
Hey, hi Emma, hi Madeline. Great to see you again. It's nice to meet up this way, and it's too bad they are so far apart, but I'm welcoming you to my home in Oslo.
Well, thank you. It's an honor to have you here. We're so grateful. And I guess we'll just jump right into it. As we saw in the video, you are the founder of Right to Play. So can you explain a little bit more about the organization and that trip that really inspired you to create it?
Yeah, I think, you know what, I was preparing for the Olympics in 94. And as any Olympic athletes probably, and many of you probably kind of experience in your own sport career, is that you are very dedicated to your performance, you know, dedicated to your team, you're dedicated to kind of development of yourself. Even in that position, I felt sometimes like I missed something. I missed something like a greater purpose for myself and for the sport I was doing. And I had the opportunity in preparation for the Olympics to participate on a trip to Eritrea. Eritrea is an African horn. It was 30 years of civil war or liberation war with Ethiopia, and they were just in peace. They were just created, the liberation was just independence. Got a new country that year, was accepted by the United Nations, and I got there as an athlete, thinking I was coming there to help them, not knowing that they were actually going to help me more so. Because what I realized on that first trip was, first of all, I saw the importance of sport in developing a country, both from a social perspective and also from the individual perspective. What I've taken for granted growing up in Norway and being around the world, we're in the safe and sound communities, is that we have play for everyone and this is accessible. Obviously, it's not. And I realized it's a life skill. It's something which is most critical. And as you heard from the video, I met this group of boys, and one of them was Mario Popola, and he just showed me like how important it was for the game itself, just to participate, to have that feeling. And for me as an athlete, I felt, wow, think if I can use my sports career to help create sports programs. Well, what if I can do something for somebody else from the platform I've been given through my performance. And I was like, wow, this is an amazing ability. So I promised them to come back with a simple sport equipment, I remember, and brought them back to them the year after the Olympics, or just after the Olympics, so 9 months after I visited them. And that's when I met the president of Eritrea. And I, you know, they were asking for food, they were asking for vaccines, they were asking for health. There were a lot of things they wanted, never asked for sports equipment or coaches. And I was like, I'm coming here, and I was criticized, as you heard. And I was like, well, you know, it's the first time we feel like human beings, like something bigger than just staying alive. And I think, you know, in all of aspects of our work with Right to Play, it's about seeing humans where they are, like, and giving the chance on the playing field to make mistakes, to try again, to experience winning, experience losing, being together in a team, and just being child, like, to everything which is in the part of life skills. And I felt, I mean, I felt a personal connection to this due to my own experience. And with that, it became so meaningful. It's the reason for establishing Right to Play. But, you know, it took a long time from my first experience. It was established in 2000 because I tried a lot of different organizations and access. I tried the United Nations to do it, and they didn't really find it valuable enough at the time. I tried the Olympic movement to do it, and they felt like it was too broad for what their responsibilities are. And therefore, we created our own organization. Well, I created the own organization called Right to Play, and saying, like, this is what we want to do and achieve, and focusing on creating a global agenda for it. I stop now, so you can ask me. It was like, wow, it was too much. And also, of course, as being an entrepreneur and creating something from scratch was very complicated. But it's been the greatest, I will say, journey of my life. It's actually even greater than the Olympic achievements, which you saw in the video. You're going to go to the next question, or should I just keep talking? Because you had, like, a lot of things you wanted to ask. But should we talk about the impact?
Maddie, if you would like to ask the next one.
Yeah, sure. So today is our Sport for Change Day, which we're looking at a lot of different things that we think sport has the ability to create a positive impact. As we've seen in our learning about Right to Play, there's a lot of ways that Right to Play uses sport to create a better impact. Our panel today covers sustainability, athlete activism, diversity, equity, and inclusion, and sport for development, nonprofit sports. How do each of these topics play a role in the pillars of Right to Play?
Okay, first of all, let's talk about impact, and then I'll talk about how it impacts all those four different areas, because it's super critical. I found what's most fascinating about what we're doing at Right to Play is we're looking at putting the child in the center for its development and figuring out how do we create a safe environment, what's the square around these children, so they can thrive even in the most difficult situations, like children affected by war, poverty, and disease, you know, where they are, like, there's lack of resources, it's a commonality. They have many experienced violence, trauma, you know, you name it. There's a lot of different elements. So what do we do that? Then we knowing there's three different factors we need to work on. Well, we work on the people who are together. So basically, training a coach becomes super critical. So they know how to dramatically different. So we're looking at the best ways a coach can impact you. And a coach is empowering you. It's giving you the knowledge and the experience to grow as your person and seeing your own talent. So we very much looked at that inside the area of the important others. The other influencers in the important others is the peers. So you set up groups where you are together with others in your community who goes through the activities and the learning as the same, because if you want long-term change, you behave very often to how you think other people think, you know, and what they do. And you almost behave like what will you, how will my friend do in this situation? You know, it's an also an element to it. And by being in, together in the complicated scenarios and training on them helps the behavior over long term. Then the experience itself, you know, the activities you're playing, this play, sport, activities, could be games, all of this is fun-based. So it's a motivation to participate, but there's always a learning from it. He's calling it reflect, connect, apply. So we're reflecting over the activities, we're applying it, or the reflecting of it, we're connecting it to our daily life. So we feel learning, for instance, you saw the health element, the protection of malaria, which is an interesting because like how can you play and learn about that? Well, there's a tons of games you can teach about the malaria, so you can teach about mosquito nets, you can teach about how you prevent the structures and what you, when you're going to take the medicine, et cetera. And you structure a game, like there's all these elements of real life to it. And then the children goes in and they're saying, wow, I'm participating in this. They become advocates for that and brings it home to their own families. They tell the importance of the net. And they lived it, they played it, they activated it. And they do it over and over again. So it becomes part of who they are. There's truth to them. So the experiences we have, regular behavior becomes part of ourselves. And then we know the third part of this is our conversation we have with ourselves in inner conversations. We have a factual one and an emotional one. We talk to ourselves all the time, like, this, and I want to give them the best possible way. I mean, there's a ways I can tell my thing to myself to become better, you know, and how I act. And these inner conversation, often in training, in sport, and you guys know this, it's like the mental training. It's like what you say to yourself has the biggest impact on the results in the end. And it's always finding the true positive sentences, which you find, which is inside you, who help you overcome your fear or your abilities, not abilities. And we do this with children in the field. We're teaching them that exact same thing so they can overcome their fear, how they can become leaders in their own communities, how they can use what they learn to be active on it when they come in situations where they need to protect themselves. So then we measure, okay, why were they staying longer in school? Our result has more than doubled the number of children. So we've gone from 50% dropout over 7 years to 96% graduation rates. We're going from, we're seeing the children going into the schools who have low average national rates. They go in between 30 to 40% of what they supports the national standards to 80 to 90% results on the national standardized test in the schools where we're implementing it. We see that from schools where there were youth pregnancies, at least 1 to 2 girls a year, this gone to zero, where we're seeing girls' marriage has disappeared in the community due to the activities we're doing. Like we're looking and we're measuring on these, what we call sustainable development goals measures of this health, education, gender equality elements where we are saying, wow, we are having a bigger impact on the larger overall goals of the country in that community. Because we know that these behavior change elements and the learning we come taking with us becomes natural to all of the children who participate due to that theory, builds on the sustainability. So there, right to play is directly connected, Madeline, to your question relating to sustainable development goals. You know, you remember, there's 17 goals. It's hard to remember them all, and we maybe not impacting every single one of them, but we are looking at the focus on education for all, quality education, which is critical, gender equality, health elements, all types of monitoring on improvement of health, obviously, which is natural, which is like the three kind of top most important ones. And then there's a number of others in relation to environment, because we create environmental groups who all of a sudden cleans up the garbage, becomes advocate for global change in relation to global warming, et cetera, et cetera. And you can go into all of these type of specific elements. When it comes to diversity, I think, which you mentioned as one of the elements, which is super key, you know, in our community, so like we are working in, you know, in over 16 countries and we're raising money in lots of these different communities. Diversity, what's critical to understand is to say, we are here not to help. Like, in some ways, it's so funny, because when we go into a community, we are there to extract the best talents and the people's ability and energy to make things happen. So it's not like we are focusing on our differences. We are focused on our equalness and the opportunity, the resilience, the strength in the community when we go in. And we found that that access to the community creates an enormous power and an empowerment, at least in those areas. Though I think you always need to have a view and a concern through the values you have in the organization, that everybody has an opportunity to speak and have a place. And for instance, when we come into a community where there are minorities, that the minorities is not overrun by the majority, and that the minority get the voice, and that they get it through the different activities and they get heard. And that's a kind of, it goes all into the process of how you structure a program over time. And I think that's super key. So everybody feel belonging to it. It doesn't matter where, what type of background you have. In relation to sport for development Spectre, obviously Right to Play has been a leader in that, and we're the largest sport for development organization in the world now, with the largest number of children participating and the largest budget, etc. That becomes a lot of responsibility. We worked in a large processes with the, towards the governments to make sure that the governments got kind of the understanding of the importance of sport for development, because we felt like a lot of governments, United Nations agencies, regular agencies, even the sport movement, didn't really see and take sport for development seriously. We didn't see it as a tool. So we used a lot of time to advocate for it as a tool, prove it through examples, structure partnerships and programming within all of the different, if the United Nations agencies, if that is through governments on the policies sides, if it's through what we call poverty reduction plans, which sits in the national governments in many of the development countries, where you're actually focusing then to add it, if it's with the Ministry of Education, to show how play-based learning can structure a more higher quality learning process for children, and et cetera, et cetera. So it's been that type of thing. So, but listen, it's 20 years since we started Right to Play, and still I'm feeling we're just scratching the surface. So we need all of you guys to join in and kind of move forward in this part. You mentioned athlete activism, and I think we should, that's a separate type of theme, because it goes much further, which I love to, when I love seeing athletes taking a stand from their platform they're standing on in relation to what they are. And we see there is a very tough thing to do, because they get often criticized, and they get often really, a lot of people want to take them down in relation to that. So it's a harder burden on athletes who takes a stand towards something they feel is unfair or just, or which is important for them. And I think, for instance, what needs to be created is more support networks and opportunities for athletes to take the stands, for anyone, if it's in a way where they get acceptable to be, because in athletes activism feels like if you say something and you make one mistake, you're taken down dramatically, instead of saying, well, I mean, I'm not going to say everything correct. I'm not going to do everything correct, but this is what I stand for. This is what who I am and what I want to articulate. And I hope that the world will listen to this, because I see unfairness, or I see unjust, or I see something I want to move. But everything I do won't necessarily be correct, even though I stand for it, you know. And then having mobilizing people. And one of the things Right to Play has done over the years is to mobilize athletes and educate athletes to their own voice. We found that through the Olympic movement, the athletes didn't even believe they had a voice. They didn't even believe they had a platform. They didn't really think that they could speak up. And what we found that they're much, much more sense to people, athletes saying, well, why would I do this? It's just not really in my nature to do it. AG, they haven't normally spoken up because they've been training all the time or they've done other things. So it's not, we found that it's not always natural for everyone, But there is many people more who wants to do it, which you need to help and facilitate and the ability to do it. And we try to do that as well as giving them right to play as a platform for advocate for the children, which we're working on with, and that so they can actually see the benefits of sport itself directly to children. Oh, Madeline, Emma, it was okay.
No, that was fantastic. I know the piece that most resonated with me is that you have a very centrist approach where you try to empower each and every individual child. I just think that is such an impactful way to empower a marginalized group of people and just really create a bigger change. And all it takes is one individual. And I think that it's really fantastic your organization can do that. And not only in one dimension, but across all these things you mentioned with sustainability, athlete activism, sport for development, and DE&I. I just think it's awesome that you guys are able to do that.
Well, thank you. I mean, you inspire me to think about something else here, because often do you wonder, like what I found is a change. Creating a change, it takes time. And to work with children, it doesn't work to go in and do something like once in a blue moon or a flash or thinking that a YouTube video is going to change their life. I mean, there's like the number of times you interact and the environment you create around them, which is going to create the safety for their own personal development to give them life skills which are positive for themselves and their surroundings. And this is really, really critical. So we feel like the regular activity is equally important than the inspirational activity, if you can see what I mean. It's like in the everyday thing, which is super key to go forward. I was thinking about also the other thing is like what I found when I did that trip to Eritrea the first time. And this is so interesting because an Olympic athlete, I already won a gold and a silver in Albertville. I won world championship. I've broken a lot of world records. A lot of people thinking like, well, you, of course, you have a purpose because your purpose is to be the best in the world. But what I found is that actually a purpose is much more different than that. Purpose is something I can see outside myself. And I say that a lot now also because of, when people are searching for purpose, they often think that they're going to find purpose within themselves. And actually, it doesn't exist in yourself. It exists in your surroundings. So if you're going to find purpose, if you're looking for purpose, you need to look in your surroundings, in your friends, in your families, in your neighborhood, in another neighborhood. I mean, the purpose you will find is a place where you feel that you can have an effect on that from your own skills. And it's outside yourself. It's not inside yourself. And it's a kind of a way, because I find that the Instagram and the Snapchat world, we are becoming so focused internally, like, how do I look? Am I good enough now? I'm chatting this picture. I'm doing this. So we become extremely obsessed with ourselves. And equally, now everybody has such a change. I'm equally obsessed with ourselves as an Olympic athlete is. As an athlete, obviously, are exceptionally obsessed with themselves for their own performance. And I found that I could never find purpose in myself. I found purpose outside. So if people looking for, and then why I'm saying that is because it's such a great guide in life, and you're going to choose something to do. Where do you want to be impacting yourself? Where do I want to spend my time on? What is my goals? It's so great to start discovering the world around us, to turn the camera away from ourselves and turn it onto the world. And finding out, okay, I see that thing there. Do I want to do that? No. I see this one. Yeah, that's an interesting. I like to check that out. And I start discovering the world instead of worrying about where I am in the world.
Yeah, definitely. Maddie and I were definitely 100% agreeing with what you said about purpose. I think especially for us as graduating seniors in college, I think that that's so important to think that purpose isn't necessarily always in us. It's how we surround ourselves with others, and that's resonates really, really strongly with us right now. So thank you, that was amazing. And before we continue on, we'd like to encourage those listening to participate in our questions function on the side. So if you have any questions for Johan, now is the opportunity to ask, and then we'll just go on with our next question. So one of the questions that did come from our students is, what's next for Right to Play? You know, what's next for the organization? And also at the same time, what's next for yourself?
Well, I have to say this, you know, first of all, we are in a tremendous, horrific timing, you know, with 1 year now with the COVID, and has been a huge impact on the organization. As on a negative side, it's because obviously income and other resources have been limited due to some of our fundraising as an organization is event-based, and you can't have any events. So obviously you realize that, oh, we had to reshape the organization on the income side to be able to have enough resources to execute on programs. And that's been a big transition in that way, trying to figure out that side of things. Then the other part is on the programming, where social distancing and lockdowns and cohorts and all sorts of things creating an incredible impact on play. I mean, you cannot play together. I mean, that's we found that we needed to digitalize, since we have had a tremendous change on the digitalization in the organizations, and we always feared it a little bit, actually, honestly, to be honest, that we feared that the digitalization is a problem, because we feel like we don't create that human connection. And we believe that change happens very much within the relationships within the people, and that we work directly with it. So the coach to the child, or the child with its peers, or the junior leader, which is so on the thing. So so what we saw was, okay, we need to create a platform where we use a digital tool to reach the people, because we can't reach them otherwise. So all of a sudden, we have kind of reshaped all of our games and activities and learning structures for a digital platform. And we've used it and actually reached more children. It's like all of a sudden, you can have an incredible impact. Though knowing that we are not only going to be a digital platform, we need the human connection to be successful in the program. But the digitalization doesn't become fearful for us anymore. It has become a tool where we can build stronger structure and support. And the other part of that from the next from Right to Play is like, okay, if we can do this to our organization, if you put some frameworks and some standards around it, maybe we can give it out to everyone. Like, it's a kind of scary element to any organization when you're saying, well, I'm giving away my intellectual property rights. You know, I'm giving away what I know the best, because it's kind of diminished the opportunity for the organization to grow. But we believe now we've kind of changed the mindset on that, to saying, well, through a process, we can actually, through other organizations, reach many, many more through the learning we have experienced and known over all these 20 years. Like, maybe putting on a digital platform, how can we empower a larger new group of organizations and groups out there to use the same tools, as long as there is within a certain standard for scary for an organization, because in some ways you feel like you don't need to be existence anymore, but you do. So it's very fascinating. So how can I volunteer and participate in helping Right to Play? I got the questions too. Maybe I should start from the bottom, but I started from the top. excuse me. We have a virus going on here in Oslo. I don't know what it is, but it's just giving me a cough and a sore throat and a fever. What can it be? No, I'm just joking. Sorry. It's a very bad joke. Anyway, I will challenge everybody. Like, what we have in Canada, we haven't had much of its success in the U.S., is we have had university clubs where the universities has come together and advocate and build programs or fundraise for the organization. Has been very successful up in Canada. Obviously, with the COVID, nobody meets, nobody do events anymore. We're having all this trouble. But you guys are graduating, so you are disappearing next year, luckily for you, and you can get on with your life. But for other people who's in the students' class and wants to create what's called a Right to Play club at the university, it's possible, and it's to contact our office either in New York or in Toronto and get there's a framework for it and doing that kind of stuff. And it's a lot of fun. I got a lot of university students coming to me later in life saying, oh, I was with Right to Play University Club, and we did all this fun sport event, and we raised this money, we learned about the programs, we did all these things, we advocated on the campus. This is a lot of good fun with that. So that's one of the challenges. I do have a cold. I tested. I'm negative. So you can't be infected. We don't send any volunteers to the field anymore. Like people, I did that in the beginning. I sent university students actually for a year, 6 months a year out in the field in refugee camps working, who had a base sport physical education background experience, and they could go out and do work for us. It was fantastic, a lot of enthusiasm, really great, but we found that this talent and the skills was existing in the communities itself, and this for sustainability reasons, so much better to employ them and mobilize them locally, which we lost one part of it, but we hope to, we lost the kind of enthusiasm for young people coming from abroad. It's like the Peace Corps kind of model, but we gained much, much more locally for long-termness of the program. All right. Are you going to read the questions? Should I read them? Are you picking?
Yeah, we can read the questions that have the most votes, so it's easier for you. The next question we have is from a student, and they asked if you could please elaborate on your shift from athlete to entrepreneur. What was difficult for you, and what obstacles did you have to overcome to make a shift in mindset?
Well, that's a great question. I'm thinking, so there is the similarities from being an athlete to being an entrepreneur. I will kind of focus on them, because if you take that with you as you want to do things in your life, and you don't need to be an entrepreneur even, it's like the three or four things which I really benefited from. As an athlete, you are self-motivated. It means you have your own personal ambition and you set yourself your own goals. Even if you are in a team, you know, if everybody as an athlete, you recognize that. That don't ever lose ambition. You know, ambition comes from dream. Don't lose dreams. Be ambitious. Don't be afraid of being ambitious. Just don't be ambitious on other people's behalf, but just be ambitious for that you want to achieve your full talent and set yourself goals in that way, and knowing that you can't win if you don't play with other people and you're collaborated in a positive way to the society and the people around you. You will have a much better role to do it. So people saying like being ambitious is a negative thing because you are, you know, taking down other people. I totally think that's wrong. So, because you can still be ambitious, you can be successful, and you can bring other people with you. So that's the one thing. Point two, find out what your passion is, the purpose, passion. What is it I want to do? So my way from going from the athlete, I love skating. When I was finished, I got a passion for building Right to Play. I mean, I loved it. I loved every day of it, even though it's kind of horrible at times. But it was like, it's kind of an internal drive. And I think an athlete understands when he talks about an internal drive. It's like almost when people come in and say, well, why do you keep training on a Saturday afternoon when we can go out partying? And you say, well, you know, I have this goal out there. And actually, interesting, when I was really in the depth of my hard work and I felt like a lot of resistance around me, I started thinking more as an athlete. I think, you know, what would I have done if I was an athlete? If I was preparing for the Olympics, I wouldn't go out and do all the things I'm doing now. I'd be focusing more. And this is it's a beautiful thing about having high ambitions, is that you're actually selecting away things which is not important, and you do what's the most important in your life. And that creates success. You pick things away. The third thing is that you start focusing on what you're good at. You know, you're thinking about, okay, this is these things I'm very good at. And you know that to be successful, you need a whole team with you. And you start identifying other people around you who can help you to achieve that mission. So you start building your own skills to motivate others to come with you on your mission. Because as an entrepreneur or as a worker, you cannot do anything by yourself, not an athlete either. I mean, you have to have everybody around you. And the easier way to have them with you is that they are also motivated by run your vision, you know? And then you have to start finding skills. What am I going to do to make other people follow my vision, you know? So you're learning that in a way of what I'm saying, saying that. So if, and then you need to be willing to see what other people are good at. And why I'm saying that is because we are always, and I've been around the world 300 times, I'm sure. I've been working in every community. And everywhere in the world, we have become really good at telling people what we don't like what they're doing. We've been extremely good at being critical and what we want other people to change. Not, we are not equally good at looking at what people are good at and describing their that behavior. So I'm saying this, a training goal is to find out what is it that I need to do, what, how can I tell you what I'm, what you're good at? How can I be able to facilitate that? And I know that because when I was as an athlete, when my coach started telling me also, not only what I needed to improve, but what I was doing really well, it lifted my performance. It's amazing how it's kind of worse. When he actually focused on what I was really good at, then I found that it was very, very successful. So those, if you take those with you as a person in your life forward, you will be successful with what you really want to do, something which you're passionate about. And it doesn't need to be saving children in the third world. It can be developing a new device for, you know, the oil industry, which I hate. But it could be something really interesting. Like, you know, it doesn't need to be necessarily good. Like, don't believe that having a purpose or a passion needs to be for something which is greater than, you know, in the social sector. It doesn't need to be in the social sector. I met so many people who are so passionate about creating a change of circuit in the world because it will kind of lower the transmission rates of electricity. And I say, yeah, okay, great. I don't understand anything what you talk about, but it's great. Or they have passion about coming up with a new formula in physics, which has no meaning in life, but it just changes their physics understanding. And I was like, wow, amazing. Find that thing in your life which you get passionate about.
I think it's really important you to find that, like, not everyone's passion is going to be the same. Sometimes you're not going to understand it, but as long as you know, like, their passion's coming from, like, a place of, like, authenticity and the power to create something better, like, I think that's really important because all of us here, I mean, most of us are sports students, but, you know, there's a lot of different avenues in which you can affect change in sports. So I just thought that was really important to know. We have one last question here for you, Johan, before we close out our keynote. A student had asked, what advice would you give to someone who wants to start their own sport for development program? What are the best strategies to build partnerships, network with other organizations, and start fundraising?
Wow, that's a big question. So first of all, I encourage, if somebody here wants to start a sport for development organizations, yes, go for it. First of all, I say always, when you want to start something, don't spend too much time writing plans. Get out and do it. And why I'm saying that is because normally it took me like 5 years before I even wrote a first strategic plan. A lot of people spend a lot of time writing a plan and never get to do it. Go out and make mistakes. If you want to start a sport for development organization, it's because you have a passion for somebody who needs it. You find a community who would like to do it. Then I will go and find out what's the best practices out there. Is there anybody who's doing something which I've done, which I want to achieve? Like, what can I learn? What is other people doing? What do I like about what they're doing and what I don't like about what they're doing? How is my program going to look? Like, I go in and develop the program and test it in the community. Go out there and try it. Stand with your sneakers in the ground and get dirty. Get your hands dirty. Jump in, get 10 girls together. Yeah, I want to change your life. Tell them and then start activities. What you're getting stuck with is like you're having like a six-week program and you had to show up every Tuesday. The great part of that is that you're learning what it means to be in a program. Then when you have defined all of these things, you kind of say, okay, well, I realize this is how I want to work in this organization. This is what my impact I want to do. This is kind of how I think a program should look like. You describe that. Then you go to a person of means, you say, because I need to fundraise. Mostly that's you find it either from your friends and family, and they start that way. You start always with the closest people and trying to convince them to give a little bit. Then you ask, every time you meet a person and you ask them for money, you ask them for a little bit for advice. What do you think I should do? What do you think? And then everybody has good advice. And then you say, well, you know what? To be able to achieve everything you say I should do, I need some money. So then they give you a little bit of money. And then the third thing you say, you know, they're going to give me money? Well, then you get to give me somebody who's going to give me money. You tell me somebody I should go to give me money. So then you ask them to introduce you to somebody else. And then you say, well, if you're going to introduce me to them, you have to give me a little bit of money, because if not, it's going to be awkward. And I come to them and say, you didn't even give me any money. So then you have like, you started fundraising. So it's like, and then you get practice on the way of it. Then you find, as you say, how you build your network and then the partnerships, which comes kind of after that, is because you kind of have a program. You know, you've tested it out. You're seeing the success. You have seen other people do what they're doing. You kind of done an analysis. You're having achievement. You have the community you want to work in. You kind of set it up. You then work with some of your friends and family or friends of family. And then you have found some resources. And then you say, well, either you need more resources to go to that sense, or you need more partnership to reach more places. And you go with your, this is what I can offer, what I need this from you, and this is what I can give to you. So you kind of build the partnerships on the mutual platform, doesn't matter where it is. And then just kind of, and expect, and this was what I was going to say earlier, in relation to athletes, is that athletes are used to resistance and losing. And it's the best thing we learn from athleticism, from our sport, is that we have lost and we've gone up and tried again. And remember, when you get a no, it doesn't mean it's no forever or it's no from everyone.
Well, Johan, thank you so much for being here. It has been an honor and a pleasure to hear from you. And we really appreciate you taking the time out of your day to allow us all to hear some of your great advice and to share your story. We're so very grateful. So thank you so much. And thank you to everyone attending our first keynote session of the McCormack Sport Leaders Forum. We are incredibly excited to keep day one of the event going. Next up, we'll have a 15-minute break followed by our first session of panels, which include athlete activism and sustainability. Sustainability will take place on AirMeet, which is the platform we're currently on, and athlete activism will take place on Zoom. Make sure you check your email from this morning to have the Zoom link. If you haven't received that, definitely let someone know. And it's important that you attend the session that you signed up for during your registration process. And thank you again, Johan, and to our title sponsor, Scout Sports and Entertainment, and to our keynote sponsor, Robin Brand.
Well, thank you, and good luck. Good luck with the rest of the two-day seminar. I think fantastic what you guys are bringing up, and I wish I was a student back then and can learn all of these things and have the chance to interact. So good luck, everyone, and have a great couple of days with all these different subjects. Good luck, everyone. Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Bye-bye.